Something familiar, something peculiar, something for everyone, a comedy tonight. Something appealing, something appalling, something for everyone, a comedy tonight. Nothing with kings, nothing with crowns. Bring on the lovers, liars, and clowns. Old situations, new complications. Nothing portentous or polite. Tragedy tomorrow, comedy tonight. Tomorrow, comedy tonight. Something expensive, something offensive.
It was 1959. I rode a bus from New York City to Cedar City, Greyhound, to interview for a job. Got off the bus at what was then the old Lunt Hotel with my little suitcase. Stepped out onto the main street of Cedar City for the first time. And a passerby, noticing me with a small suitcase, smiled and said, "Welcome to Cedar." I damn near dropped the case. I hadn't seen eyes in over 6 months in New York. They don't look at you in New York. They just bump into you. And that was the beginning of a love affair that I had with this phenomenal community. I have never regretted that bus trip. And I never, ever wanted to take it back. I'm not going to say it was easy, but damn, it was fun. And I met marvelous, marvelous people along the way. People that have retained their footsteps in my heart ever since. Many long gone. We buried more than in this room. But we had a wonderful, fun time. I had found a community that loved Shakespeare. And when this green-faced 28-year-old kid went to them and said, "I'm going to do Shakespeare," I got to admit, the Chamber of Commerce, well, the idea went over like a pregnant pole vaulter. but there were people that said, "Yeah, let's try it." And they joined me, a postmaster, a clerk in the department store, the manager of JCPenney's. We had a JCPenney's then. They said, "Hey, we'll help. Sure." They'd put on tights, memorize lines. And so we grew in this strange country, this strange land, this strange environment that you now find yourselves in. But I think the thing that is going to impress you the most, you have a community here of 30-some-odd thousand people that are absolutely thrilled that you're here. Not for the economy, not for the crowds that'll come in and crowd up their grocery stores and their restaurant lines and everything else. They're thrilled because you have given time to come to this out-of-the-way area to take your phenomenal talents and share them with us. And they're so thrilled and so grateful to have you. Smile at them on the street. They'll smile back. Get acquainted with somebody on the street. They'll talk back with you. They'll visit with you because they're so thrilled you're here. And I ask just one sweet little favor. In this community, the F-bomb is offensive. May not be where you come from. Maybe your grandmother uses it all the time. I don't know. But here we don't. We've come up with some replacements for it. Fire truck. Fudge. But we don't use the F-bomb. We don't use it, especially if we're around our patrons, our neighbors, and our friends. And we respect the word of God. It's not a swear word to us. It's not even an everyday word to us. It's so special, we don't use it. So the name Jesus Christ or God are just not used. And I hope that in public at least, you'd guard your language for the sake of our patrons, neighbors, and friends. And above all else, oh my goodness, I hope you have the most fabulous summer of your life. Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Bishop Ethan Bunker, a good neighbor and a friend, and was Fred and Barbara's bishop.
I'm Father Bob Stokig, member of the Board of Governors and friend of Fred, like all of you.
I'm Rabbi Fred Wenger. As a rabbi in Utah for over 38 years, I'm here to honor Fred. Well, I've loved channeling biblical heroes and making them live. One of my favorites is the Maid of Moab. Moab, Israel, that is, not Moab, Utah. Ruth's love of family, of God, and of homeland remind me ever of the love and joy that Fred Adams showered on my family and on myself. Fred blessed our hearts with his winning smile. We shared many a meal. Fred inspired us all with his love of Shakespeare's genius. Over the years, in short, Adams and Wenger shared a Fred and Fred thing. In 2009, when my wife was recovering from life-threatening pancreatitis, she persuaded me to get away from Salt Lake City, bus down to Cedar City, and take in plays. Friends, ambivalently and with heavy heart, I arrived on Wednesday, lost myself in Shakespeare, and completed my mind wash on a Saturday night. Fred ran into me at the Green Show. "Where's Rochelle?" he asked. I shared with Fred her slow recovery and my escape. "Where are you staying?" he asked. "The Zion Motel," I replied. "Then the simplest, cheapest, sleaziest motel on Main Street." "How will you get to the bus station tomorrow?" Fred queried. "I'll take a cab," I replied. "Rabbi, you don't know where you are," Fred roared. "You'll get no taxi in Cedar City, Utah, on a Sunday morning. Barbara and I will pick you up at your motel and drive you to the bus station." Of course he did. For Fred, this was a simple mitzvah, a good deed sprung from his open heart. For me, it exhibited a love so rarely found among high-achieving, Tony-winning impresarios. It reminded me of Ruth's loving devotion to Naomi, Boaz, God, and her destiny in the Promised Land. So preparing for this tribute, I found no Ruth among Shakespeare's corpus, although some of you Shakespeare experts may correct me, please. Tonight, however, her spirit reappears to me as the devoted, practical maid of all work, Ruth, straight from the decks of the Pirates of Penzance. Listen, and listen to what she sings. I hope this is going to work. Now, let's see. When Frederick was an undergrad in Russian and production, he did avow he'd sometimes wow as a witty academician. The Korean War taught him far much more of his lifetime's mad compulsion. To Cedar City he returned, burning just like jet propulsion. His dream grew while at USU, Fred and Barbara made their plantic. The festival grew, faced obstacles new, and numbers geometric. From three old plays to three stages gay, green show and old time feasting, your fingers you can politely lick, seminars and backstage touring. If you would ask just how his task sprang up in just one lifetime, Banquo's ghost and Hamlet's dad would come to us in quick time, telling love of God and Avon's broad with commoners and patricians, Fred wouldn't have found that he'd been bound as a wicked academician. And so we've come, sat on our bum, pray tribute to his memory. We hereby swear his dream to share, continuing Fred's legacy. We owe him far much more than to adore his unique personality. We support the Shakespeare Festival, and Fred will smile in ecstasy. Thank you and shalom to you all.
I met Fred Adams in a flower bed, just out here behind the Randall Jones Theater. By met, I had my first conversation alone with him because I had already heard him do orientation talks and shaken his hand yearly near the Sugar Shack outside the Adams Theater, surrounded by hundreds of other festival faithful. But this time, the year the Randall opened, it was just Fred and I. He, of course, was busy planting flowers in what would become a flower bed, but was still a bare plot of earth. As I approached him, I asked if I could help him. Surely he had something more important to do on a busy late afternoon at the Utah Shakespeare Festival. He said to me, "There's always time to bring a little beauty into the world. People will be coming across the street tonight after the green show, and I don't want them to be greeted with just this bare dirt." As the years went on and I got to know him better and better, I came to understand how that theme is what made Fred C. Adams a part of the fabric of all our lives. Whether by flowers or other beauty, by his smile and his capacity to make everyone feel you weren't just the most important person, but the only person, Fred always seemed to make time to bring a little more beauty into the world. The way Fred could hover over what was and coax forth what could be reminds me of how the book of Genesis begins. The Creator hovers over what in Hebrew is called tohu vabohu, primordial chaos, and brings forth land and light, plants and people, as the garden is coaxed forth from that chaos. Something Fred knew intuitively is that there is a relationship between chaos and creativity. Like the story in Genesis, he could see beyond the chaos to that what was and see the beauty that could emerge. And sometimes that was filling a barren plot of land with flowers. Sometimes it was seeing in a young actor something that they didn't know they had to bring to a performance. And sometimes, in the beginning, it was seeing a world-class Shakespeare Festival in what was a small southern Utah town, and to know that it could be a place that would draw people from all over the world to see and to hear the beauty of the words of the bard on the page come into full bloom before our eyes. He knew that to do this, you could never squelch the tohu vabohu completely. Instead, you had to help it take shape and find in it the colors that would bring it to life. Several years later, while at a Board of Governors retreat, I found myself again alone with Fred, this time on the deck of a cabin above Cedar Canyon. We were looking out at the fall colors which had begun to emerge and talking about life. Utah Shakespeare Festival had recently produced the Spitfire Grill. And as we talked and gazed at the emerging colors in the canyon, Fred turned and said, "Look, Bob, aren't the colors of paradise splendid today?" Fred could not only see and appreciate all that was in front of us, he could give it a name that would say far more than the syllables he uttered. Some years later, alone near the sculpture garden, Fred told me the news that his cancer had returned. As our conversation came to a close, knowing that this was serious, I looked at him and promised my prayers. And then I said, "If you see your time is coming, are you ready for the colors of paradise?" With a tear in his eye and a smile on his face, he said, "I love you," and gave me a big hug. That in turn gave me the gift of being able to say, "I love you," to Fred every time I would see him in those remaining months. So three things that the thread of Fred's life and the fabric of my own life have given me to remember: there's always time to bring a little beauty into the world, to notice that creativity can emerge from what looks like chaos, and to quote the closing lines of Les Mis, "To love another person is to see the face of God."
As we all saw in Fred's intro there to the last festival, you knew that he loved his Savior and he loved God, his Heavenly Father. And he went after the one. And that's what I've always loved about Fred. Doris Williams is a neighbor of mine and Fred's. She's quite a tenacious but very loving lady who has joined Fred in paradise now, but years ago, back in 2007 in December, she had had a nasty fall and had fractured her back. She was at LDS hospital recovering from that fracture. And I'm going to read the story from Doris's daughter. She said, "In September 2007, Fred Adams came to LDS Hospital in Salt Lake City while our mom, Doris Williams, was recovering after having traumatically fractured her back. He spent quite a while with her. The nurses were all awestruck and wondered who this person was," Doris, not Fred, they knew Fred, "who was Doris that Fred Adams would be visiting. Some of the nurses stopped him and asked him for his autograph. Then they asked him, 'Who is this important person that you've come to see and visit?' He said, 'I came to Salt Lake City to see my good friend Doris Williams and Governor John Huntsman, in that order.'" This is exactly who Fred was. It did not matter how famous or popular you were, your status or your title. as we all know, if you were fortunate enough to be Fred's friend, then you truly were his most famous and most popular person when he spent time with you. May we all do as Fred did. May we lift where we stand, and may we serve others wherever we go. Thank you, Fred. Thank you. Thank you.
Welcome to North Star, a celebration of the life of Fred C. Adams. I'm Frank Mack, executive producer of the Utah Shakespeare Festival. I got to spend about 3 years with Fred, but I learned more in that time with him than I did in 3 years of grad school. And it's a good thing, because shortly after he passed, the festival and the world entered a serious crisis. It was Fred's tutelage that guided me. Countless times when I didn't know if we could do it, I asked myself, what would Fred do? His answer was always clear: of course you can. That's how Fred became my North Star. As we navigated some very dark seas, his light has been a beacon. And I finally understood why he wore such bright colored clothing. I'll follow that transcendent light forever, and I'm grateful for his many gifts and for his legacy of creating the festival and now guiding it forever. I'm also grateful to all of you for coming tonight for this marvelous celebration. I want to thank our sponsors of the season dedication to Fred, the Sorensen Legacy Foundation, the Crocker Catalyst Fund, and Jeffrey and Katie Nelson. I want to thank Fred's family. I want to thank the committee that has worked these many months to prepare tonight's event and the Southern Utah Museum of Art. I also want to thank the production staff and crew and members of the performance company. Together, they bring the magic to life here every day, and they're going to do so here tonight. Some amazing work went into tonight's celebration, and I'm grateful to all who made it so, and to get to share it with all of you. Keats wrote, "A thing of beauty is a joy forever." The life and times of Fred C. Adams is such a thing of beauty. Tonight, we celebrate his joy, and we recognize the beauty of his star that will shine forever. And now it's my pleasure to introduce our host for the evening, the Artistic Director of the Utah Shakespeare Festival, Brian Vaughn.
Good evening. It's so good to see everyone here. As Frank said, I'm Brian Vaughn. And welcome to this evening. This is my laundry basket. Inside my laundry basket are some things. There was a lot of talk previous to this evening that I had with Dorcas Adams about Woodward, the possibility of maybe donning some of Fred's clothing for the event, and maybe a few toupees here and there. Spoiler alert, Fred wore a toupee. I know he wore it well, but he wore a toupee. there was just something in me that I thought, yeah, I don't know. I don't know if I can rock the short gray suit with the matching lime green shirt, tie, and socks with as much panache as Fred would rock. And that is my word indeed for Fred C. Adams, panache. To me, that word exemplifies in every way what I believe is a truly theatrical gentleman. I will tell you the beginning, and if you please, you may see the end. for the best is yet to do. And here, where you are, they are coming to perform it as you like it. In the beginning, there was the Word, and the Word was Fred. It was 1960, and a young Fred Cruikshank Adams, the newly appointed drama professor at the College of Southern Utah, was fresh off the bus from New York City, ready to make Broadway-caliber theater happen here in beautiful Southern Utah. One glorious afternoon, while watching their laundry spin at the Fluffy Bundle laundromat, Fred and his fiancée, Barbara Gaddy, had a vision for a festival, a Shakespeare festival, right here in Cedar City. And like a modern-day Don Quixote, Fred Adams began to dream. And on a yellow notepad, Fred Adams and Barbara Gaddy began to put down on paper the blueprint for what would become the Utah Shakespeare Festival, or rather, the Utah Shakespearean Festival, as it was originally called. You know, like Shakespeare. Shakespearean. 2 years prior, Fred had a fortuitous trip to Ashland, Oregon, to visit the famed Oregon Shakespeare Festival, one of the oldest Shakespeare theaters in the country, which had been running some 20 years earlier than USF. And during that visit, Fred began to cultivate a lifelong friendship with Angus Bohmer, the founder of Oregon Shakespeare Festival. And during that time, Fred began to bend the ear of Angus on all the steps that one may need to take to begin to create such a dream. Well, OSF is very similar to USF. Both are in small towns with junior colleges. Both are surrounded by some of the nation's most beautiful landscape. Well, what Cedar had going for it was three national parks within its borders, and luckily, a newly formed I-15 passageway that drove right through Cedar City. Fred's idea of a destination theater in southern Utah was actually possibly not such a crazy idea after all. The first step in seeing this dream realized was convincing Royden Braithwaite, the president of the college, on the idea. Well, the president loved it. However, the college did not have the budget to support a large or even a small festival. But they could, however, pay the utility bills, provide a place for rehearsals, and dorm rooms for the actors. The plays would be performed on an outdoor stage next to the auditorium. And however, Fred, he needed lumber to construct the stage, the scenery, the props. He needed fabric for the costumes and the materials. Fred needed money. So he turned to the city for financial help. And as Fred said in the video, that idea went over like a pregnant pole vaulter. My personal favorite phrase of Fred C. Adams. But the city had zero funds, unfortunately, available at the time. And the Chamber of Commerce also declined, and so did the Elks, and the Rotarians, and the Kiwanis. And after almost throwing in the towel, he was finally greeted with glowing support from the local Lions Club, who offered to cover any shortfall that may occur that season, up to $1,000. $1,000. And with that $1,000, the Utah Shakespearean Festival began. Three plays over two weekends in July: The Taming of the Shrew, Hamlet, and The Merchant of Venice. Why these three plays? Well, the college had done Taming of the Shrew 2 years earlier, and they still had the costumes. Check. Romeo and Juliet was performed the winter before. Well, we can't do that one this summer since we already did it, but half the costumes would work for Hamlet, check. And historically, The Merchant of Venice had been performed in the Cedar Valley by the Mormon pioneers some 100 years earlier. So that seemed an appropriate choice. And the beautiful thing about Shakespeare is everything is in the public domain, so no royalties. The stage was set, the actors were ready, and the audience had arrived. And for 2 weeks in July in 1962, the first season of the Utah Shakespearean Festival began, ushering in 3,726 visitors and over $2,000 revenue. Double the amount supplied by the Lions Club and enough to fill the coffers to begin planning that second season. Since the first season in 1962, 60 years ago, the Utah Shakespeare Festival has produced 330 productions of classic and contemporary plays and musicals, 198 of them productions of Shakespeare. Not to mention the thousands of green show performances, the multiple educational tours, the thousands and thousands of hours devoted to producing live theater by thousands and thousands of employees who have given their heart and soul to work for the Utah Shakespeare Festival. Three theaters, eight plays in repertory annually, 350 company members, 30 of them full staff, and roughly 100,000 tickets sold per year with an annual operating budget between $7 and $8 million. And it all began at the fluffy bundle and a yellow notepad. One simple idea blossomed into one of the richest cultural experiences in the country, putting Utah on the theatrical map, garnering an Emmy Award, a Tony Award, and worldwide acclaim. Entertaining, educating, and enriching hundreds of thousands of people from all over the globe, right here in Cedar City. Tonight, we don't mourn the loss of this remarkable man, but we celebrate the laughter, the vision, the love, the legacy, the heart, the guiding light, the North Star that was Fred C. Adams. Among the many treasures that Fred found, that we found, that Fred passed in, or left along in his passing, was a list of 20 moments that define who we are, who USF is. How Fred was able to identify 20 among the hundreds and hundreds of memorable theatrical moments that have enriched audiences over 60 years is beyond me. But this is Fred's list. And we will celebrate a few of those moments on this stage tonight in tribute of the man we have all revered, we have all loved, and we have all deeply, deeply admired. What started as a seemingly impossible dream at the Fluffy Bundle was indeed reached over the spirit and the guidance of Fred C. Adams. Here this evening to remind us of that spirit and pursuing that impossible dream, and to celebrate that dream becoming a reality, is a performer whom Fred loved, singing one of Fred's favorite songs. Please welcome from our current production of Ragtime and Richard III, Ezekiel Andrew.
To dream the impossible dream, to fight the unbeatable foe, to bear with unbearable sorrow, to run where the brave dare not go, to right the unrightable wrong, love pure and chaste from afar, to try when your arms are too weary, to reach the unreachable star. This is my quest, to follow that star, no matter how hopeless, no matter how far, to fight for the right without question or pause, to be willing to march into hell for a heavenly cause. And I know if I'll only be true to this glorious quest, that my heart will lie peaceful and calm when I'm laid to my rest. And the world will be better for this. That one man scorned and covered with scars still strove with his last ounce of courage to reach the unreachable
Thank you, Ezekiel. And please, let's have a special amp for Brad Carroll on the piano. Brad is a longtime director here at the festival. His work this year is making our musicals, The Pirates of Penzance and Ragtime, such standout productions. But on that list of 20 moments, Brad Carroll directed The Man of La Mancha, Les Miserables, and The Spitfire Grill. And he was the composer of Lend Me a Tenor. Mr. Brad Carroll, thank you so much. Over the years, Fred had many partners in helping him build the dream he and Barbara had that day at the laundromat. One of those partners is here tonight. R. Scott Phillips is a lifelong friend, former student, and colleague of Fred's, and he currently serves as a city councilman for Cedar City. He served in several positions over his 40-year career at the festival, culminating as executive director in 2007. Friends and colleagues, Mr. R. Scott Phillips.
Well, it doesn't get any easier the second time around. As I stand before you tonight, I'm reminded of a comment Fred made to a group of very nervous amateur actors 60 years ago. Quote, "Just remember, God gave us these nerves so we would do better." Unquote. Well, I'm nervous right now, but I know Fred's with me telling me, "Scott, you can do better." There were some remarkable spirits that pushed that first season and willed the Utah Shakespeare Festival to happen in all of the strangest places in the world, Cedar City, Utah. Of the original core of dedicated artists, only one remains with us today. We are honoring our dear friend and grand impresario, that's twice tonight we've heard that word, Fred C. Adams. But I would be remiss if I didn't recognize someone who is with us tonight. The festival's first technical director, stage and set designer, lead carpenter, stagehand, prop master, and business manager, Gary McLean McIntyre. Mac, would you please stand and allow us to publicly thank you. Had a deep love and an abiding friendship with Fred that went on for decades. Mac stood by all of us prior to his retirement from the festival almost 20 years ago. In 1963, Fred began to surround himself with others who could help him achieve he and Barbara's dream. A young university professor by the name of Doug Cook joined the artistic team as scenic designer, and Cameron Harvey as lighting designer and production director would soon follow. These two men, along with Fred and Mac, formed a quartet that would build a permanent place in Cedar City for professional live theater. I began my first season with the festival as a summer intern in 1974 and became the first full-time employee in 1977. The combined service of those four men, along with myself, represent a collective 219 years of dedicated service to this organization. In the first years of the festival, each night of the season was a costume processional. The audience would line up in the courtyard just before curtain and watch as the actors would pass by dressed in their beautiful costume regalia. The patrons loved it and thought it was another of Fred's big ideas. But in reality, it was the only way to get the actors from the basement of the auditorium dressing rooms to the outdoor stage. There was no basement in the Adams Theater temporary stage. Finally, in 1974, we had raised enough funds for permanent seating. We removed the existing patio and dug a hole for the first basement connecting the tunnel from the Adams Theater to the auditorium. The costume processional went away after 14 seasons. Actors were happy and relieved. The audiences, not so much. The 1970s and 80s were a time of great change and growth for the USF. The budget grew from just over $300,000 to just over $3 million in 20 years. The popularity of the festival had grown, and we were playing to 101 to 105% capacity over a 13-week performance season. So how did that happen? Well, Fred would not turn anyone away from seeing a production. He would insist that we put extra folding chairs in the aisles. We would add folding chairs down the side of the Adams Theater to get everyone in. In fact, the row J, the final row of the Adams Theater, was always planned to be a walkway, but Fred insisted that we put seats in there so more people could see the plays. That's why they have the infamous pole seats in row J. The relationship between Fred Adams, the Utah Shakespeare Festival, and this community is a love story told through drama. I can't imagine Fred left this world with too many regrets. As he had visited numerous countries, he dined with kings and presidents, he saw most of the natural wonders of the world, he married a remarkable woman who shared his dreams, he raised an incredible family, well, mostly Barbara did, but he was there. And he built a performing arts center to carry on his legacy. Many years ago, Fred wrote a birthday card to me, which I still have. It said, "Thank you for being guardian of the dream." Tonight, I ask you to help be guardians of the festival dream. For dreams are fleeting, they are fragile, and they can be gone in an instant unless they are shared, remembered, and cherished. In closing, I would like to read a part of a speech that Fred gave on opening night of the festival 60 years ago. A lovely piece of land has been granted to the festival by the College of Southern Utah, and on this land eventually will rise a replica of Shakespeare's Globe Theater, complete with ivy-covered walls, fluttering flags, and a Tudor facade to serve as a background for the plays. On these grounds, we will find reflecting ponds and a babbling brook, cool picnic areas placed under the trees, and in the distant corner, a sonnet garden surrounded by a statue of William Shakespeare, complete with fragrant herbs mentioned in so many of his plays. This is our dream. We realize it will take years to accomplish, but we are not in a hurry. The popularity of William Shakespeare's art has lasted for centuries. We are sure it will continue to last until our dream reaches its fulfillment. Fred was like the beautiful Aurora Borealis that he always talked so much about. He was never the same. He danced. He sparkled. He was colorful. At times, he was elusive. He shimmered. He was life-changing. He was constantly moving. He asked all of us to look up and marvel at the world's brilliance. Fred was our Aurora Borealis, and maybe we didn't even recognize it. Thank you.
Thank you, Scott. Cameron Harvey first worked at the Utah Shakespeare Festival as a lighting designer in the early 1960s. Over the years, his roles and responsibilities grew to include producing director and then producing artistic director. Friends of Fred, Mr. Cam Harvey.
The year was 1969. Hair was the big hit on Broadway. Men were about to land on the moon. I just graduated from college, and Doug Cook hired me to light the season at the Utah Shakespeare Festival. I met Fred at our first company meeting, grinned broadly at his description of how everyone's various body parts would dry out in Cedar's climate, learned that we had to reassemble the stage house from scratch, and that we would be housed in Cedar's first hospital converted into a dorm. Oh my, said I, and thus began my journey with Fred and Doug that continued for the next 37 years. Those early years were simply wild, and we did them all on pure adrenaline. If yours pooped out, Fred would simply share his endless supply with you. I was lighting, Doug was scene designing, Fred was directing. We had a fabulous time, but all felt the frustrations of dealing with a temporary theater year after year. We frequently ate lunch together, brainstorming the future, and on one of those days, Doug was unusually quiet. And when we were getting up from the table, he tossed down his napkin and said, "Hey, what do you guys think?" On it was a sketch that would become the Adams Shakespearean Theater. Soon thereafter, I added a stage lighting scheme, Fred launched a fundraising drive, and the rest is history. With Fred's genius of leadership and personality out in front, Doug and I worked as producing artistic directors to help develop the next stages of the festival. To Fred's magnetism and zeal, we offered a mix of professional contacts, standards, and production organization. Good things began to happen. The quality of performance and stage work improved. The Adams Theater was built. And in time, we went on to do it again with the Randall Theater, this time based on a conceptual sketch from my hand. Fred always knew that irrespective of what the leadership team did or did not do, members of the company, volunteers, and the community at large were at the heart of the festival's success. And he made sure that sentiment was clearly expressed on the stage of Radio City Music Hall on Tony Award night. Nothing, however, was quite as magical as that first summer with Fred at his house, watching the moon landing after a Sunday hike in the misty rain at Zion with the entire company. Of course, Fred hoped there would be moon men, but alas, there were none. The company did see some moisture revisited to their dried body parts, thanks to the Zion sprinkle, and they all had been touched by the grace of a man who loved and appreciated each of their contributions. From start to finish, working with Fred was challenging, rewarding, and absolutely unforgettable. He will always be in my heart, and I'm sure he will always be in yours. Love you, Fred.
In addition to starting the Utah Shakespeare Festival with Barbara, Fred was also a beloved faculty and staff member of the College of Southern Utah, now Southern Utah University. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome interim SUU president, Mendy Benson.
None of you stood for the fight song. First off, I have to say I have nothing sparkly in all of my clothing. I looked through it all. So I did what Fred would do and piled on the jewels. He taught me well. I bring you greetings from Southern Utah University, where Fred Adams worked 61 years of his life. Let that sink in. 6 decades committed to education and art. Think of the lives that he changed. And in my new role, I think of all the presidents that he had to train, who was truly in charge of this campus. I watched that happen with Jerry Sheeran and Fred won, and it made me laugh each time I saw that battle. I loved it. Fred is the very part of the foundation and the fabric which makes SUU what it is today. He is and embodies SUU, and he is what the rest of us strive to be. He carries that spirit, and we all carry on his legacy. One of Fred's lasting legacies are the thousands of SUU alumni that he inspired. To this day, everywhere I go, and speaking with alumni, somebody always brings up the impact that Fred had on their lives. Whether it was trips to Washington, D.C., or happened to meet, you know, President Kennedy on that trip, because that's what Fred did, was introduce people to things, or launching careers, helping people get jobs at the Utah Shakespeare Festival, or teaching them how to create the magic. Each learned and grew because Fred and all that he taught them and was willing to spend the time doing with them. I consider myself part of that legacy of Fred. I started my career at SUU as a 12-year-old tar girl. And no, that was not a pretty picture. But boy, did I have fun, and I learned so much. That was a formative time for me, and that is where Fred became my North Star. Fred taught invaluable lessons, whether he meant to or not, that I still take with me this day. Fred taught me that people are always the most important priority. Always. It's about people. The second thing he taught was lead by doing. Don't talk about it. Just go do it. The third thing he taught, which I use in many of my events, is there must be magic moments, even if we secretly have to stage them. My go-to has become cue fireworks, right? That's what Fred taught us. He taught us to take care of the details, and he taught me that nobody is above straightening a rug or picking up a piece of trash. And these are things that I will use to lead SUU in the coming months. Those are my North Star that I will use. In one way or another, Fred shaped all of us, his students, SUU, and the Utah Shakespeare Festival, and made this world a better place because of it. Fred's legacy lives on in each of us. Let us carry on his light and his legacy by teaching, caring, and fussing over others as Fred fussed over us. I guarantee when Fred passed, after running into the arms of his sweet Barbara and many other family members, that there were a gaggle of blue ladies fussing over Fred, who continue to follow him around to this time. Let's continue that legacy of taking care of each other. Thank you.
Thank you, Mindy. As a proud SUU alumni and a former student of Fred's, I can vouch for Fred was an amazing teacher, actually. One of my favorite classes, personally, was theater history, because you never quite knew if Fred was actually telling you the truth. These lovingly became what are known as Fred facts, where we would often whisper to somebody, is that true? Is that really true? And you would often hear, it doesn't matter, it's a great show, isn't it? So thank you, Fred, for that. One of the performances Fred cited in his 20 moments was Melinda Funstein in My Fair Lady. She's appearing this 60th anniversary season as Mother in Ragtime and as Queen Margaret in Richard III. Melinda is here tonight to recreate one of the most joyful moments from that performance. Friends of Fred, please welcome Melinda Funstein as Eliza Doolittle from the Utah Shakespeare Festival's 2004 production of My Fair Lady.
Bye. just you wait. Henry Higgins, just you wait. You'll be sorry, but your tears will be too late. You'll be broke and I'll have money. Will I help you? Don't be funny. Just you wait, Henry Higgins, just you wait. Just you wait, Henry Higgins, till you're sick. And you scream to fetch a doctor double quick. I'll be off a second later and go straight to the theatre. Ha ha, Henry Higgins, just you wait. Ooh, Henry Higgins, just you wait until you're swimming in the sea. Ooh, Henry Higgins, and you get a cramp, a little wise from me. When you yell, you're gonna drown. I'll get dressed and go to town. Ah-ha-ha, Henry Higgins. Ah-ha-ha, Henry Higgins. Just you wait. One day I'll be famous. I'll be proper and prim. Go to St. James so often I will call it St. Jim. One evening the king will say, oh Liza, oh thing, I want all of England your praises to sing. Next week on the 20th of May, I proclaim Liza Doolittle die. All the people will celebrate the glory of you, and whatever you wish and want, I gladly will do. Thanks a lot, King, says I in a manner well bred. But all I want is Henry Higgins' head. Done, says the King with a stroke. God's run and bring in the bloke. Then they'll march you, Henry Higgins, to the wall. And the king will tell me, Liza, sound the call. As they raise their rifles higher, I'll shout, ready, aim, fire! Oh, Henry Higgins, down you go, Henry Higgins. Just you wait.
TV watchers know him from his many recurring and guest appearances, and he has entertained Broadway audiences in roles such as Scar in The Lion King, Lumiere in Beauty and the Beast, and his Tony-nominated performance as Hades in Hadestown. The Utah Shakespeare Festival family knows him for 6 seasons as a leading actor here in Cedar City. He's currently shooting a film in Boston, but he wanted to make sure he was a part of this evening. Friends of Fred, Grammy Award-winning and Tony-nominated actor, Patrick Page.
The word I think of when I think of Fred Adams is the word dreams. Shakespeare said, we are such stuff as dreams are made of. He gave that line to one of his wisest characters at the very end of his career as a writer, so we better listen up. So what does that mean? We are such stuff as dreams are made on. Well, I think maybe it means if everything that happens, everything that is created, happens first in our dreams, happens first in our imagination. So we've got to listen to our dreams. And Fred Adams is, more than anyone I have ever met, a man who did that. You're sitting right now inside his dream. The Randall Jones Memorial Theater was, when I came to the Utah Shakespeare Festival in 1984, not there. It was just a bunch of houses. Fred saw a theater where the entire beautiful Utah Shakespeare Festival complex is now was once, when I first came there, just, as I said, a bunch of houses. Fred saw an Elizabethan village. Fred saw a theater. Fred saw possibilities. That was his great genius. And he saw in a skinny 22-year-old kid with a funny deep voice, an actor. It was my first job. And he didn't see a skinny 22-year-old kid. He saw Marcus Brutus. He saw Richard III. He saw Macbeth. He gave me the courage to be an actor because he saw my potential. He saw possibilities. So thank you, Fred. It's because of you that I get to have the life I have now, and it's one that I treasure. I can never thank you fully.
One of Fred's favorite performances by Patrick was as King Richard in Richard III. And you know what Richard III makes me think of? Politicians. In person tonight, we have State Senator Evan Vickers and Cedar City Mayor Miley Wilson Edwards, and a video greeting from Governor Spencer Cox. Senator Vickers started his political career as a member of the Cedar City City Council and has represented the area in the Utah House of Representatives and the State Senate. In that time, he has continued to be a strong advocate for the festival on both the local and state levels. Mayor Wilson Edwards is a Cedar City native, the granddaughter of a two-term Cedar City mayor, and in 2013 became the city's youngest and first female mayor. This proud Thunderbird graduated from SUU with a degree in political science, and most importantly, she is a former volunteer and an ongoing supporter of the Utah Shakespeare Festival. Please join me in welcoming Senator Vickers and Mayor Wilson Edwards.
You know, it's such a humbling experience to be before you today, tonight, and to say something about Fred. So let me just tell you quickly about two things, one personal and one not. I was born in Panguitch, Utah. I grew up in Beaver, Utah, as the traditional Southern Utah hick. My idea of culture was listening to The Doors or Black Sabbath as loud as I could get it. I met someone who changed my life. I met two people, and the first one was my lovely wife, Chris. She introduced me to the fact that there actually was great beauty in music and lots of different variety in music, that it was okay to sing in the ward choir, and that I better or I was going to be in trouble. And then we moved our family to Cedar City in 1980, and I met Fred Adams. And I immediately knew that I was Fred Adams' very best friend. And he introduced me to live theater and the beauty of live theater. And then from that point on, Chris bugging me to make sure that I got the tickets, Fred always coming into the store and reminding me about what was going on in the festival, my life has been so much more rewarding because of that. Now, I stand before you as a state legislator. I serve in the state Senate, I'm the Senate Majority Leader, but I have to tell you that I'm here representing many, many, many current legislators, former legislators, governors, lieutenant governors, staff people, lobbyists, you name it, anybody on the Hill that has anything to do with on the Hill, know and love Fred Adams. In 2011, I was in my second term as a House member, and we wanted to recognize Fred for his 80th birthday on the floor of the House. And so we worked behind the scenes to get things ready. We had a nice little resolution that we'd drawn up. And so the House is raucous, you know, and Speaker Wilson's wife is sitting here and she knows what I mean. There's 75 and it's kind of buoyant and raucous. The Senate's more sedate. And of course, there's all sorts of jokes going back and forth on that, but it is. It's just a noisier place. And so that particular day, it was noisy. And I sat over to close to the front, over by the speaker. The speaker always had me over there to make sure that I didn't get in trouble. But the door that, you know, we'd bring our guests in was right there. And it's, you know, it's off to the side. And so it came time, you know, to recognize Fred. Well, there wasn't any announcement or anything like this. You know, we're now going to recognize Fred Adams. That came later after we got him out. So the sergeant-at-arms, the green coat, opened the door, ushered Scott and Fred in. And I think Donna and others were with him. And it was spontaneous. I heard somebody say behind me, "It's Fred Adams." And immediately, every member of the legislature, everybody who was on that floor, gave him a standing ovation. Before his name had ever been announced, before anybody really even knew he was there, it was spontaneous. That was the love that Fred Adams had on the Hill. So over my 13 years in the legislature, it was my privilege to join in many, many meetings with Fred Adams. As Fred and Scott and others, they'd come up and we'd go and we'd have to meet, we'd ask for money, we'd beg for money. But I tell you, because of Fred Adams, it is so much easier. And every one of us, speaking as legislators, former legislators, we all knew that we were Fred Adams' very best friend. Thank you.
As a child, I was always intrigued by the glitz and glamour of those on the silver screen, as well as the up-close and personal live theater performances. For as long as I can remember, I have been involved in some aspect of the Utah Shakespeare Festival, as Brian alluded to. For some may even say that I was born into it, since my grandparents, parents, and close family and friends were all involved in the Shakespeare Festival since its very beginning 60 years ago. When I was in elementary, I was approached by none other than Fred Adams himself to see if I would be in the production of Babes in Toyland. I was so excited, as this was my big theatrical debut. Each performance, I remember sitting just over there in the wings off stage, watching Miss Muppet scream as the large black spider was dropped right beside where she was sitting. As the production came to an end, all I wanted to memorialize my experience was Miss Muffet's spider. I begged my mom to get it for me, but she refused, saying that if I really wanted it, I had to ask Fred personally. She also figured that that would get me out of having to get this. So as a shy little girl, I was shy back then, I quietly approached the bigger-than-life figure, Fred, and asked him if I could have the spider. And he laughed as only Fred could laugh and took me over to retrieve my treasured spider, which remained in my room for the next decade. Fred has always been an influence in so many aspects of my life. He has what some would call an eccentric personality, but he was a master at his craft and truly one of my very best friends. No one could quite understand how a 33-year-old and an 89-year-old could be best friends with the most fun, snarky friendship imaginable, but in our case, it just worked. Fred opened my eyes to the world and expanded my views on culture, community, and theater as I was able to travel to faraway places with him for more than a decade. Each trip was a unique experience, yet they all shared a few common variables, including us laughing until late hours of the night, usually because we'd been lost somewhere where we were too interested in window shopping than actually paying attention to where we were going. And anyone that knows Fred also knows that he was directionally challenged, so it wasn't that surprising. On my first trip as a young college student, I remember walking out of a restaurant where we had just finished dinner, as Fred adamantly declared that we were going to turn right and that would lead us back to our hotel. Alternatively, Scott, stated that we would be going left to get back to the hotel. Well, we all followed Scott's lead. The entire walk back, Fred continued arguing that we were going the wrong direction, and even as we approached the hotel, he emphatically stated that he was going to get a map and prove that his way would have in fact got us back quicker. Now, being the young, snarky girl that I was, I wanted to see the final results of the direction debate. So I went to Scott and Fred's hotel room. Scott's gonna kill me. Fred opened the door and I let out a blood-curdling scream yelling for my mom. As embarrassing as this is to admit, I had never paid attention to the fact that Fred wore a toupee. Fred opened the door, map in hand, but without his beloved toupee on. But he was dressed in blue plaid pajama shorts. As I screamed, Scott came from inside the bathroom to see what the commotion was all about, also without hair and in matching blue plaid pajama shorts. I doubled over laughing at the sight of these two men that I so looked up to, hairless and matching, while still debating who was right and who was wrong on directions. Fred was a master storyteller, as been described tonight, who oftentimes didn't necessarily let facts or details get in the way of the good story. When I was very first pregnant with my daughter, we were on a boat trip in Europe. Although I always got seasick, this information didn't stop Fred from informing everyone that I must be pregnant. As you can imagine, where I was basically one of his kids and pretty much the favorite, he wanted me to have a baby as soon as I got married. So when I confronted him about the fact that he was spreading this gossip, he merely shrugged and said, "I can neither confirm nor deny that I said anything." Luckily for me, I was able to remind people that oftentimes Fred information came in the form of Fred facts, so it wasn't always correct. After I made it past the first trimester, we both laughed at how we used each other's strengths and weaknesses against the other one. Fred had an incredible way of bringing people together and making everyone feel as though they were the most important person in the world at that moment. He could connect with people better than anyone I have ever witnessed. It did not matter if you were a head of state or a young child, he always made time to make you feel important. Being as close as I was to Fred gave me a perspective unlike anything I can even describe. People from around the world would recognize him when we would travel, and you could hear the whispers on airplanes as we boarded of individuals questioning whether, in fact, that was the Fred Adams. And during my time as mayor, I had the opportunity to work with Fred professionally to better the city and the festival alike. I truly miss my dear friend, but I am so grateful for the role he played in my life and the life of my family. There are few people in this world who left the type of lasting impact that Fred did, and even fewer that impacted and were best friends with four generations in one family. I am forever grateful for the chance I had over these years to have a front row seat and watch the master conduct his life day to day. Fred and I shared a unique bond that few could understand and had a one-of-a-kind friendship that always involved us joking around and making ridiculous comments back and forth and sending memes. Walt Disney stated, "If you can dream it, you can do it. Always remember, this whole thing started by a mouse." Here in Cedar City, this dream didn't begin with a mouse, but instead with Fred Adams. It was his vision and leadership that made the crazy idea of creating a Shakespeare Festival in the middle of a desert in a small rural community in Utah into a world-class center for the arts. As we look to the future, remember the endless possibilities, and as Fred put it, look up. Thank you.
The toupees, they were like the Cadillac of hair pieces, though, right? Governor Cox is from the 1,300-person-strong city of Fairview, Utah. He served its residents as a city council member, mayor, county commissioner, and state representative before being appointed lieutenant governor in 2013. He won that office outright in 2016 and continued to serve until 2021 when he was sworn in after being elected governor. We take it as a good sign that his swearing-in ceremony was at a performing arts center and that his Southern Utah office is right here at SUU. Friends of Fred, Governor Spencer Cox.
Hello, I'm Governor Spencer Cox. It is an honor to speak to you on this celebration night, recognizing the achievements of my good friend, Fred Adams, a visionary artist and administrator, as well as a beloved theater professor at SUU. Fred was a tireless advocate of the arts and a key arts leader who was always thinking of others. He founded the Utah Shakespeare Festival in 1962, and it forever changed the character of Cedar City, and indeed all of Utah. His warm, charming, and charismatic personality was very welcoming to visitors at the festival. Tonight, we remember Fred Adams' legacy and vision of a Shakespearean festival in the hot desert of Utah. We honor his love for art, his joy and brilliance. I love mostly the time I was able to spend with Fred on stage, where he lit up every room he walked into, and when he was in front of the people at Shakespeare, he transformed into the incredible artist and storyteller that he was. We desperately miss Fred, and we're grateful that we're able to celebrate his brilliance tonight.
I got married at the Utah Shakespeare Festival, actually in Las Vegas, Nevada, in between rehearsals for 12th Night at the Utah Shakespeare Festival. And a couple of nights after our wedding in Las Vegas, Fred took my wife, Kate, and I to dinner, just the three of us. And at that dinner, we didn't talk about the play that was about to open. We didn't talk about the green show or the festival or theater or any of it. All Fred wanted to talk about was how important Kate and my love for one another was, and how over the years we would need to stand for that love for one another and be committed to the living presence of that love with each other. And it touched me so deeply, and Kate so deeply. Even now recounting it, I'm again moved by Fred's commitment to our relationship. Kate and I celebrated our 44th wedding anniversary this past week, and that dinner, that conversation with Fred Adams lives in us to this day. His care and his commitment to our relationship was something remarkable, something I've never seen or experienced from anyone else, and I am deeply grateful for it to this day.
Fred, thank you for giving me a chance to be dimensionalized, to be all things that are possible, and for teaching me about being outward-facing, and for teaching me about what it means to be really customer-centered and experience-centered as an organization. And thank you for your belief in me. I miss you. My relationship with Fred, mentee, friend, colleague, admirer. It's hard to sum up my feelings in one word about Fred or my relationship with Fred, but I would say inspiring. There are probably a lot of stories about Fred that might intersect with this, but the one thing that I've always found incredibly powerful being in his presence and watching him in terms of story or anecdote was his general care about the campus of the Utah Shakespeare Festival. It always blew my mind when I would call and he would answer the phones, or when I'd see him out there on the grounds into his 80s, picking up trash, tending to the flowers, making sure that every piece and every corner of the festival were showing in their best light.
My first season as a director with the festival was for Two Gentlemen of Verona. And I was hired as a replacement for a director who pulled out. And I had never been to the festival before. So when I got to the festival and began rehearsals, I kept my nose to the grindstone and I just did the work. And I noticed from time to time that Fred was sitting in the back of the theater, but I was too shy to actually go up to him and talk to him about the show. On opening night, Fred brought all the directors to the front of the stage, as he was wont to do, and introduced all of us. And at one point, he reached back, took me by the hand, and moved me to the front of the stage and said to the audience, "I just want you to know that this little lady can hold her own with all these gray-haired men on the stage." I was embarrassed. I was dismayed. My cheeks were red. I didn't know what to say or do. And he just held on to my hand the whole time, giving me confidence. And he was that way throughout the time that I was at the festival. Every opening night, he rewarded me with a bracelet that was always designed somehow to support the design and intention of the shows. So I have almost 20 bracelets that Fred gave me over the time. One like this one from A Midsummer Night's Dream, and one from Richard III.
Fred's famed love of Disneyland is utterly fitting with all of this. It seemed to inspire an unblemished sense of wonder and joy. I believe that wonder and joy, and yes, of course, his heroic will to get the thing done at all, was at the core of his 6 decades of magic at the Utah Shakespeare Festival, almost 20 years of which I had the joy to be a part of. Fred's will, his determination, are legendary. An entrepreneurial saga of guile and nerve, salesmanship, and inexhaustible energy. The magic was on stage, and the costumes, and the poetry, the comedy, and the dance, the drama, and the songs. It was on the grounds, and the flowers, and the statuary, in the Grove seminars, and the Green Show. It was in Fred's legendary orientation talks, where unique Fred facts, often astounding, sometimes bewildered, and always entertained. It was in his simple act of connecting, reaching out and shaking hands, greeting all who came back year after year for the glories of Shakespeare and the musicals and all the rest of the program. Audiences who came back year after year for the magic. The transformative is what an artist is all about. In that, I will always think of Fred Adams as an artist in his own right, a transformer of time and place, instance and purpose. Utah Shakespeare Festival in Cedar City, Utah is proof of that, for USF is surely the stuff of dreams and miracles. Fred Adams was its maker, and the festival's magical life in the transformative carries on, giving cause and hope for all of us to carry on with an ardent belief in the power of theater to transform lives. That is the magic.
I'm not Brian Vaughn. Thank you for laughing at that. I wasn't sure if that would work. My name is Derek Livingston. I am the Director of New Play Development and Artistic Associate here at the Utah Shakespeare Festival. Stop or I'll do Hamlet, and I know it. And I had the pleasure of chairing the committee for tonight's event. I never met Fred. I'm the new guy. I arrived on April 19th. They said, "Oh, by the way, our very revered founder, we're doing this celebration for him. You're in charge of it." I would be a horrible chair if I did not thank the committee members for their work, dedication, and support.
Thank you, Michael Barr, Mindy Benson, Lee Byer, Sarah Greener, Richard Gertan, Ben Holman, Don Jersey, Donna Law, Bruce Lee, Jeff Leader, Frank Mack, Shauna Mendini, Tanya Searle, Maria Twitchell, Brian Vaughn, and Fred's favorite, Dorcas Woodward, but I wasn't supposed to say that part. I also have to thank the crew that is working on this event tonight and the entire staff of the Utah Shakespeare Festival who all contributed in their own ways to making this event a reality. Fred C. Adams lives! His spirit burns brightly in the minds, hearts, and memories of so many people, some of whom are here tonight. I couldn't name them all. James Pearson and Leah Frank Wright. I'd love to hear him present the play for us before the performance. I would never miss those. Lynette and Mark Hudson Wright. We've attended for 40 years. Fred treated us like family. Cheryl and Peter Robbins, the Smiths, the Muds of Cedar City, made several trips with Fred over the years. Former colleague and friend, colleague, former teacher, outstanding mentor, say Brandon Burke, the Phillips, Virginia Stitt, Maverine Lamb, Douglas Hammond, Sadir Maruti, the McCliff Allens, April Holiday, the Stravels, the Hoffines, and Jim Volz. Because of Fred's teaching us what to see in a play, we are now working as a lighting designer, stage manager, and props person for our theater in Arizona, the Sharps. I was Fred's administrative assistant for 17 years, Susanna Morris. I played piano for Fred's Ward Choir for 15 years, Jennifer Wood. He was my Sunday school teacher, Sherry Tagney. I had him as a professor and then worked at the festival with Fred for 14 years, Marla Eiler. The Braithwaite's right. Cedar City would not be the cultural center it is today without Fred's vision. I have been a devoted follower, audience member, and patron since his first play. I was there. Colleen Broadbent Paddock and Ken and Lori Pulchlick Wright, 32 years ago, Fred designed our Shakespearean-themed wedding. Fred C. Adams lives, he lives, he lives. He is our North Star, burning brightly in the hearts of multitudes. Burn bright, Fred, burn bright, burn bright. And Brian Vaughn.
Thank you, Derek. Give a round of applause for Derek Livingston, who was the chair of this event for this committee. Thank you so much, Derek. It's impossible to talk about the Utah Shakespeare Festival without giving special acknowledgement to Barbara Adams and her vision for one of the most unique and treasured elements of USF. From the very beginning, the festival was more than just plays. Fred and Barbara envisioned a courtyard of dancers, music, madrigals, puppet shows. What began with strolling madrigal singers and musicians playing recorders on the lawn has blossomed into a nightly ritual with performers playing on multiple stages, maypoles, egg dances, and tons of huzzas. The vision Barbara had in the early days of the Green Show has blossomed into a festival favorite, and currently the Green Show has three separate shows. It plays six nights a week and captivates audiences nightly, with crowds frequently reaching over 1,000. It has become a treasured element that has showcased the greatest talents in the country and has delighted audiences of all ages. The Green Show is in every way a gift to audiences and to our local community, with audiences flocking to the Green for these free performances near the Barbara Adams Memorial Garden. This spirit of expansion, rooted in Barbara's vision, paved the way for other fully produced events the festival is known for, including past productions of The Royal Tea, The Royal Feast, which I was in, as well as literary seminars, production seminars, actor talkbacks, pre-show orientations, backstage tours, Words Cube new play readings, all helping pave the way for the festival's 1999 expansion of productions playing into the fall. To you, Barbara Gaddy Adams, I give you an incredibly heartfelt huzzah. Huzzah! One indelible production and performance from Fred's top 20 list is Misty Cotton as Percy Talbot in the festival's 2004 fall production of the Spitfire Grill. Here to sing the show-stopping Shine from Spitfire via video is Misty Cotton.
There's darkness in me, as deep as this valley, and things that I've done I can never repay. The days I regret are too many for counting. There's sin's river diamond of hope in this dark heart of mine. Morning light, shine on me, shine. Find a diamond of hope in this dark heart of mine. I ain't asked for much in this life I've been living. I learned early on that I'm here all alone. No matter how close I stand to the fire, it still makes me shiver and chill to an ember of heat. There's a diamond of hope in this good heart of mine. This
year's Special Regional Theater Tony Award goes to the Utah Shakespeare Festival, Cedar City, Utah.
Making a Shakespeare Festival
become a very real thing and bring the very best of culture and refinement and art, the work of the great playwright, to Cedar City.
It had been a trying day. Arriving at our apartment, I was in a black mood. I was reminded we had a youth activity that evening, a hike. We bundled up and began to hike to a cabin in the countryside. And kicking at the frozen earth and trying to be careful not to trip in the ruts in the road, I almost didn't hear. A young girl's voice rang out, "Everyone, look up!" I did. And for the first time in my life, I saw the Aurora Borealis. Northern lights. Curtains of greens and blues, pinks and gold shot back and forth across the black sky, dancing and waving at the heavens. I stood there, transfixed by the wonder of it, and the sky of pure black velvet studded with diamonds so large and so dimensional that it was as if I could reach out and touch them. And I almost missed it. Kicking at the frozen clods of Earth, I almost missed seeing one of the most miraculous and beautiful sights on Earth. Thanks to her cry, "Look up," I had witnessed one of my life's highlights.
Hi, I'm Maria Twitchell, Executive Director of Visit Cedar City Bryan Head, the Tourism Bureau for Iron County.
Hello, I'm Scott Phillips, Cedar City Councilman. Throughout his life, Fred Adams has inspired hundreds of thousands to marvel at the wonder of our world, to dream, and to look up. Cedar City owes much to his success to his marvelous vision. That's why we're excited to announce two projects honoring Fred's legacy. First, the Cedar City Historic Preservation Commission will dedicate at Cedar City's 170th birthday this November an historical marker here at the Fluffy Bundle Laundromat site, where Fred and Barbara, on a yellow notepad, first envisioned the Utah Shakespeare Festival.
And second, Visit Cedar City Bryan Head has commissioned a stunning mural to be installed here in Cedar City's historic downtown. Painted by Parowan native Kyle Vincent, this mural commemorates that night when Fred first saw the Northern Lights. We hope this mural will inspire community and visitors alike to always look up.
What a beautiful recognition of the birthplace of the dream and a memorial of the vision. Along with these two wonderful honors, on August 5th, 2021, Utah United States Senator Mike Lee put forth a resolution remembering and honoring Fred Adams into the congressional record. This resolution will be on display in our lobby for all of you to view, and a portion of it reads, "Fred's life story is a testament to how personal initiative can catalyze growth and unite community. He tirelessly worked to see his dream of the Utah Shakespeare Festival realized and tirelessly loved his family, his friends, and his community along the way. And as a result, Cedar City has grown, the festival has drawn international praise, and we all benefit from the example he has left behind. So when times are tough, when work seems monotonous, and when dreams seem far-fetched and far gone, remember Fred. His story can inspire us all. As any arts leader will tell you, you are better when you have a strong, committed board of governors behind you. Friends of Fred, please welcome Utah Shakespeare Festival's Board of Governors Chair, Brian Watabe, and a previous chair, Jeffrey Nelson.
On behalf of the Board of Governors of the Utah Shakespeare Festival, I'd like to thank each of you for being here to celebrate the life of our founder, Fred C. Adams. It has been a privilege and truly one of the great joys of my life to serve with Fred, and so many of you, to build this great dream of his into a beautiful reality that has blessed our lives in so many ways. I want to share a Fred story that I really love, and I've asked Maddie to join me on stage to help me share that story. As many of you know, Fred and the Utah Shakespeare Festival have given our children a love of theater, the arts, and especially the beautiful people who make this magic happen. They love coming to the festival, and they love seeing the shows, all of the shows, again and again and again, and that can go on. Yes, even Henry VI, part two and part three. But one of the plays most responsible for starting their love and one of my all-time favorite festival plays was Peter and the Starcatcher. So I was thrilled to see that on Fred's list of his 20. And Peter wasn't the first play that the kids saw at the festival, but it was the first play that they insisted on visiting again. Maddie, who's here with me, was very excited to see Peter, Molly, and the Black Stash. But 8 years ago, she was only four. And the festival has a policy, I shouldn't admit this, right? That you have to be six to attend the plays, so I broke the rules and brought Maddie to the show. Then, like Tate with his daughter, I rehearsed with her. If anyone asks how old you are, you are six. How old are you?
Six.
Six, okay, good, right. So as we sat, somewhere right around here, if I remember correctly, waiting for the show to start, Fred approached us. Oh no, he's gonna ask how old Maddie is, I knew it. And in my mind, I'm repeating, say you're six. Instead, Fred, honing right in on Maddie, beaming in the way Fred always did, asked her if she would like a cushion to sit on so that she can see the show better. The love, the joy in his voice, in his eyes, it was everything. And yes, she would like a cushion. The care, love, energy, and joy Fred gave each of us has made our lives better. Fred showed us the way to love each other and gave us this beautiful festival as a place we can return to each year and show that love for each other. It hurt a lot last year when Fred left us. As Molly says in Peter and the Starcatcher, it's supposed to hurt. That's how you know it meant something. But then she adds, this isn't the end. You're going to remember everything. Thank you, Fred. We will remember you always as we carry your light and love with us every time we gather here to celebrate your dream and love each other.
I first came to the Utah Shakespeare Festival in 1978. My parents decided that this would be our summer vacation destination. I was just 10 years old and had to talk them into letting me go to the first play. I prevailed and was able to attend instead of going to childcare. We continued coming to the festival each year throughout my youth. One summer, I invited my then girlfriend, Katie Jones, to join my family on our annual Shakespearean pilgrimage. We were later married and started our own family. When our kids were old enough, we continued the tradition of attending the festival. We had our favorite actors and plays, and we also began to know the family around the festival. Fred's orientations were a staple for us. Fred would take time with us as he did for everyone. He would ask me about my father, who he knew loved Shakespeare. He would take time with my son, Alex, a person of neurodiversity that doesn't always connect easily with others. Regardless, Fred quickly became his favorite. When my daughter was just old enough to attend, we brought her to her first festival play, Camelot. We were nervous about how she would do at her age and if she'd enjoy the experience. And I promise Brian and I did not coordinate this, but to our great surprise, we were met in the aisle by Fred. He said hello and immediately retrieved a booster cushion for Riley. So apparently he's bringing boosters for everyone. His kindness and attention to our little family blew our minds. And of course, Riley loved the play. Alex and Riley quickly became Shakespeare super fans, and we continued the tradition of attending each year. Eventually, in considering colleges, Riley attended tours at several institutions. SUU was on the list, and really, it was no competition. She already loved the festival and the people, and Cedar City was like our second home. This made her decision very simple. While attending SUU, Riley eventually met her husband, Ryan Cooper, another Shakespeare superfan, wouldn't you know? They now live in Cedar City, and we have yet another reason to continue to faithfully visit multiple times a year. I share our story only to emphasize the remarkable impact that Fred and his family's founding of the festival has had on our family, and we are just one. Consider for a moment the many families impacted by and enriched by the art, experiences, and relationships created by this incredible place. Fred and Barbara's founding of the festival made a big splash, and the ripples of that splash continue to intersect with each of us, creating a lasting, positively amplifying effect. Our family has a unique place in our hearts for Fred. He will always be in our pantheon of specials, with the likes of Walt Disney, Jim Henson, and of course, thanks to Fred, William Shakespeare. We are better for the polishing we've received here by interacting with so many of you, so many amazing people, and because of the incredible experiences we've shared and will continue to share as part of the festival family. We will always be grateful for Fred, for his daring vision, his persistence to follow his dreams, and his enduring love and kindness to each of us. Thank you.
On Fred's list of 20 moments, he identified the festival's 2012 Les Miserables ensemble as being a standout. Brad Carroll, didn't you direct that production?
Is that why I'm out here?
Yeah.
I think I did.
Yes, you did. And didn't you also substitute conduct also that production?
Yes, I think I did,
yes.
In fact. And Mr. Vaughn, who played Javert in that production?
Some hack.
Well, could that hack take his place
for this next bit? Certainly.
Excellent. Fred, this is for you.
One day more, another day, another destiny, this never-ending road to Calvary. These men who seem to know my crime will surely come a second time, one day more.
I did not live until today. How can I live when we are parted?
One day more.
Tomorrow you'll be worlds away. And yet, with you, my world has started.
One more day all on my own.
Will we ever meet again?
One more day with him not caring.
swear I will be true.
But he never saw me there.
One more day before the storm,
I follow where she goes.
At the barricades of freedom,
shall I join my brothers there?
As our ranks begin to fall,
do I stay and do I dare?
We will nip it in the bud. We'll be ready for these schoolboys. They will wet themselves with blood.
Watch them out of luck. Catch them as they fall. Never know you know when there's a free for all. Here a little dip, there a little touch. Most of them are gone, so you won't miss much.
My place is here, I fight with you.
One day more, I will learn their little secrets. One day more, we'll be ready for these tomorrow boys. Tomorrow is the judgment day. Tomorrow we'll discover what our God in heaven has in store. One more dawn,
one more day,
to say, singing that song in 2012 was a thrill of a lifetime, and I think the audience felt the same way. It's really wonderful. Thank you. Father, husband, founder, friend, mentor, colleague, teacher, director, actor, storyteller, jokester, promoter, iconoclast, pioneer, dreamer, innovator, visionary, guiding light, with wit, humor, and style, Fred was all that, and the consummate leader. A testament to that leadership is the staff he gathered around him, who worked with Fred for years and continue to work at the festival. Representing long-term staff is a trio that alone represents over 70 years of service to the Utah Shakespeare Festival: Jeffrey Leader, Michael Karchner, and Cammy Terry Paul.
We have to follow that, you guys. I thanked Fred many times for not founding the festival in St. George. I don't think I would have lasted 36 seasons down there. It's hot. I came here fresh off my first year of teaching college at the University of Wisconsin, thanks to a late night conversation with Sandy Robbins and a call to Doug Cook. Like Cam Harvey, I really didn't know what I was getting in for. I quickly learned that this was more than a job or a summer gig. I was welcomed into a creative, empathetic, enthusiastic family of artists, and I stayed forever. I live here now full time. Fred and Barbara taught me, through their example, the spirit of generosity and goodwill.
through the many aspects of the festival that were given away without charge, the green shows, the orientations, the seminars, Fred created an atmosphere and environment for patrons and staff that caused us all to own things, this place, more than we could ever be paid for, or more than patrons could ever pay for. Whether he calculated it or it just happened, he always credited Barbara for all those ideas. This aspect of the festival was uncommon and important. It's critical to its life's blood. Fred was in touch with every aspect of the festival. He knew staff members' names. He valued each individual's contributions to the festival. We worked harder, longer, stronger, faster than we ever thought possible. And he was always rolling up his sleeves to help if we were behind. Under his guidance and leadership and love, we benefited from the joy of creating something as a company that we could never do individually. In his memory, I strive to continue beautiful, creative, and important work every day. Thanks, Fred.
I don't know how to put 30 years or 946 million seconds into just 3 minutes. But I'm just kidding, Frank. It was the summer of 1989. That was my first year at the Utah Shakespeare Festival. But that's not when I became a freshman. It was the spring of 1989 that I became a student at Southern Utah State College. I was invited at the behest of a great man that sits in my family row right there, Mr. Mack. He gave me the first and the last scholarship called the Utah Shakespearean Festival Theater Scholarship. I was a technician. I was a stage manager. I did things behind the scenes. And for the last 30 years, I've been that stage manager. I've been that tech person. I've been that person behind the scenes. And I've appreciated the many opportunities that I've had to serve at the Utah Shakespeare Festival. One of the biggest things that happened in 1989, of course, was the opening of this beautiful theater. I call it my theater, because I was the first technicians to pull those ropes on that side of the theater. I was the first technician to put the stage together in this theater. It was my opportunity to be a part of that. And I will always remember that first season. Imaginary Invalid, Nothing Like the Sun, directed by my friend Scott Phillips, and The Glass Menagerie. What a wonderful time for a first-time freshman to be able to partake in. It was just fabulous. It was hard as heck, but it was just fabulous. I have my first contract. It's right here. Talking about $1,000. I only got $350 more from that $1,000. So my first contract, $1,350 to work here for 3 months. I don't know how many you would do that today, but that's pretty cheap labor right there. I treasure that little signature that I have right there, Fred's signature. It means a lot to me. That same year, in the fall, going into Christmas, we did a wonderful show. And Peter has been a very going throughout this whole show, but Peter Pan was the show that we did that year for a Christmas show. brand new in this theater, and I happened to be the fly master for the show. I loved it. Fred was a nervous wreck. We had never tried to attempt to do anything like that ever. And I remember when Flying by Floyd came in and set us up in here, and how nervous I was to grab those first ropes and start flying those three kids and Peter Pan and Glennis Adams at that time. I was not to hurt that precious cargo. And so I remember climbing a 16-foot ladder on this side of the stage, all the way to the top, jumping, grabbing the rope, just so I could bring Peter Pan through the windows for the first time. And Fred, sitting back here on the side of the stage, making sure that it happened flawlessly every single time. He loved his students. I was a student. He was the only man that could get me into tights. Here I am, a stage technician, but they needed someone to play Henry VIII in the cavalcades. And so I had to don some nice white tights. Only person that could do it would be Fred C. Adams. Over the years, I got to really love Fred. I was with the festival for 30 years. And my last bout was the director of facilities and technology. And because of the perfect example that he had set by being in the gardens, by picking up the trash, I tried to follow that example. I got a purple shirt out of it. He was a good man, but I also want you guys to know that he was a man of God. God was his number one, family was his second, and this country was his third. And because he was a man of God, he knew how to love everyone. That's why you are his brother. That's why you're his sister. And that's why we were taken care of by him, is because he lived a God-like life. He loved his calling in the church. 25 years he taught gospel doctrine to members of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. For 13 or 14 years, he was the choir director, and he would have his mini tabernacle choir in the 16th ward. And when he would go on his trips, he would go find matching ties and matching scarves and dress up his choir, because he was so proud of what he could do with those choirs. And lastly, he was a man of God because he loved to go to the temple. And he loved serving people as a man of God in that temple. And the stories that I would hear as I would be driving him to different locations, we didn't talk about work. We talked about God. And he increased my testimony of the love of what God and what he has planned for us as his kids. So take that with you. He loved you because he loved God.
There's a quote from Bill English of the San Francisco Playhouse about theater that says, "Theater is like a gym for empathy. It's where we go to build up the muscles of compassion, to practice listening and understanding and engaging with people that are not just like ourselves. We practice sitting down, paying attention, and learning from other people's actions. We practice caring. After my first trip to the Utah Shakespeare Festival back in the 1990s, I was hooked. I loved the Adams Shakespearean Theater. I loved the storytelling. I loved the whole experience. I started what I thought of then as my dream job after I finished college working at the Utah Shakespeare Festival. One of the happy memories I have of Fred is going to Universal Studios in Florida. I missed the day going to the Disney park, but watching Fred in that park, he knew how to do an amusement park. He could rival the enthusiasm and excitement of any child, and I remember him going down the log flume over and over, laughing every single time. We also went to the new Harry Potter world, and he had to experience every corner, every store of that space. It was so magical to be with him. Any car ride, though, with Fred was an occasion for funny stories, some of them true. Planning the future of the festival, and Fred introducing everyone else in the car to whatever the latest musical was that he had discovered and wanted to share with us. Watching Fred connect with company members, friends, festival guests over the years showed me how well Fred understood how to connect and care for people. A well-known quote says, "People may forget what you said, people may forget what you did, but they will never forget how you made them feel." Everyone who knew Fred will always remember how he made them feel. I feel the tremendous honor of being on the team who will steward Fred's festival into the future. His legacy is strong, and I love what it is and what it does. Thank you, Fred. We'll take good care of this thing you built.
Fred rarely took the stage during his time at the festival, but it is appropriate that one of those times was as our general. Here we see the man himself stopping the show in the Pirates of Penzance as the modern Major General.
I beg pardon?
Yes.
Could you do that last part a little bit faster?
Our revels are now ended. These, our actors, as I foretold you, were all spirits and melted into thin air, into thin air. And like the baseless fabric of this vision, the cloud-capped towers, the gorgeous palaces, the solemn temples, the great globe itself, yea, all which it inherit shall dissolve. And like this insubstantial pageant faded, leave not a rack behind.
We are such stuff as dreams are made on, and our little life is rounded with a sleep. If you could please rise and join me in raising your light. Fred, thank you for your warmth, your wit, your generosity, your spirit, your care, and the legacy you have bequeathed us all. You will forever be our North Star.
If we shadows have offended, think of this, and all is mended, that you have but slumbered here while these visions did appear.
Complications, nothing portentous or polite. Tragedy.